kids. It's Mrs. Kaiser here. We are going to be reviewing fractions this week, so here we go. A fraction represents part of a whole. The whole could be an object, a group of objects, or a number. All fractions have a numerator and a denominator. Here's the fraction 3/4. Let's see what that looks like. Here's 3/4. Here's another example of 3/4. And a number line example of 3/4. Some fractions look different but can represent the same amount. We can call these equivalent fractions. So down here we have 1/2 is equal to 2/4, which is also equal to 3/6. Let's see images. Here's 1/2, 2/4, and 3/6. They all have the same amount shaded. They are all equivalent fractions. You can easily compare fractions when they have the same denominator. Here we have 6/8 and 3/8. The pieces of the whole are the same size because they are both eighths. So 6/8 is greater than 3/8. You can also easily compare fractions when they have the same numerator. Here we have 4/8 and 4/5. Eighths are smaller than fifths. If there are four of each, then 4/8 are less than 4/5.
We are learning about fractions this week, and I thought it would be fun to share my very favorite peanut butter cookie recipe with you. So I'm gonna make that with you guys, and I wanted to share the ingredients first. We're gonna be using some salt, some butter, some brown sugar. This is flour and white sugar. We have peanut butter, of course, baking soda, baking powder, some Crisco vegetable shortening, and then finally an egg. Now I'm gonna get my measuring cups out so we can get started. Oh no, kids, I can't find my measuring cups anywhere. I don't know if I can make this recipe without my measuring cups. I have to be able to measure each of these ingredients. I mean, all I have are these two tablespoons. What am I supposed to do? Hey kids, sorry I flipped my lid there. I've calmed down now. We're gonna go ahead and keep baking because luckily I know how to use equivalent fractions and I have an Amazon Echo here. Hey Alexa, how many tablespoons are in a cup?
1 cup is 16 tablespoons.
Okay kids, if 1 cup is 16 tablespoons, 16 of these, then I know that 1 tablespoon is the same as 1/16 of a cup. Perfect. So I've went ahead and drawn this chart out, and I'm gonna go ahead and start with my sugar. I need 1/2 cup of sugar, so I'm gonna color 1/2 cup on this chart, and then I'm gonna find the equivalent fraction using these squares. Now each cup that I've drawn out is 16 squares. So each one of those squares represents a tablespoon. If this is 1/2 cup, then I can color the same amount of blue squares to find the number of tablespoons that I need in my recipe. Let's see how many tablespoons of sugar I'm going to need. There we go, now I've got the same amount. That's 4/8 tablespoons is equal to 1/2 cup of sugar. So I'm gonna go ahead and get my sugar and we're gonna count out 8 tablespoons of sugar. Here's my sugar. I've got a spoon in it because sometimes I use it for my coffee in the morning. All right. I'm gonna make. 8. All right, so I have just measured out 8 tablespoons of sugar. That is the equivalent of a half a cup of sugar. So that tells me that 1/2 is equal to 8/16. All right, let's keep baking. Next is the brown sugar. I also need a half a cup of brown sugar. So I'm gonna color a half of a cup on my chart. And just like the regular sugar, that half a cup is going to be 8 tablespoons. So 1/2 of a cup is equal to 8 tablespoons, or 8/16 of a cup. Let me get my brown sugar, and I am going to measure out 8 tablespoons worth of brown sugar, because that's equivalent to half of a cup of brown sugar. Next is the peanut butter, of course. We also need a half a cup of peanut butter for these cookies. So I'm gonna color 1/2 of a cup on my chart, and the same number of tablespoons is 8. So 1/2 of a cup is once again equal to 8/16 of a cup, which is 8 tablespoons. So I'm gonna open my peanut butter up, and we're gonna scoop 8 spoonfuls of peanut butter in with our tablespoon measuring. One more, just for good measure, because I really, really like peanut butter. All right, that's it for the peanut butter. Next, I need some shortening. So I'm gonna add 1/4 cup of shortening, but remember, I don't have my measuring cups. I only have this tablespoon. So I am going to find out how many tablespoons 1/4 cup is equal to. So I'm gonna color 1/4 of the cup that I've drawn on this page. Remember, 1 cup is 16 tablespoons. So I've colored 1/4 of that shape. If I split it into 1, 2, 3, and 4 sections, this is one of those 4 sections. The same number of tablespoons is 4. So I need 4 tablespoons of vegetable shortening. That means that 1/4 is equal to 4/16. Awesome. So I need 4 tablespoons. There's my tablespoons of shortening. Next, we add 1/4 cup of butter and an egg. So I'm gonna cut this stick of butter in half, because 1/2 of the stick is 1/4 of a cup. You can also see that it is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4 tablespoons, just like we had figured out earlier. So now let's add our butter. Awesome. And I'm gonna add an egg. And then we are gonna mix that all up until it is all mixed together. Okay, next I need to add the flour. Now I need 1/4 cup of flour. So I've drawn 2 different charts here. I'm gonna color 1 of the whole charts in to represent the whole cup. And then I'm gonna color 1/4 of the other chart in to represent 1/4 cup. So I need to color 1 of these whole charts in, that's all 16. And then I need to color in 1/4 of the next chart. That's just 4. So 16 plus 4, that makes 20. That tells me that 1 1/4 cups is equal to 20 sixteenths. So I'm gonna add 20 scoops of flour. All right, next I need 3/4 teaspoon of baking soda. So I've got 1/4 teaspoon here. I'm gonna do 3 scoops. 1/4, 2/4, three quarters. I need 1/2 teaspoon of baking powder. So I'm gonna add 2 of these because 2/4 is equal to 1/2. 1, 2. And we need 1/4 teaspoon of salt. All right, we're gonna mix it up and see how it goes. Okay, kids. Next, I'm gonna take a baking sheet and I'm gonna spray it with a little bit of Pam so that my cookies don't stick too much. They do have a lot of oil in them, so I don't have to use very much because that oil is gonna help them to naturally stay off the pan. Okay, now I'm gonna take my tablespoon and I'm gonna scoop a big old heaping scoop of cookie dough. I'm gonna take it out and I'm gonna form it nicely on the pan. And I'm gonna take a fork. I'm gonna kind of just touch the top of that cookie so I get a little bit of that oil on the fork. And I'm gonna dip it in some sugar that I have right here. And then I'm gonna use that to create a crosshatch pattern on the surface of the cookie. So I'm gonna press the fork in it one direction and then the other, and that's gonna create this really pretty pattern on the cookie. That sugar's gonna bake really nicely. It'll get really sweet and kind of crunchy. Let's do another one. I wanna make sure that I only do about 3 cookies in a row so that they don't run into each other. And I think I can probably fit about 5 rows on this pan, or 5 columns on this pan, I'm sorry. There we go. I'm gonna go ahead and do all of my cookie dough and then I will let you know before I pop them into the oven. All right, kids, we've finished putting our cookies on the cookie sheet and I called my mom and I asked her, made sure I have her permission, and I went ahead and preheated the oven to 375 degrees. Make sure you ask your parents' permission too before you touch the oven. Okay, now I'm gonna go ahead and put these cookies in the oven. We're gonna set the timer for about 9 minutes and we're gonna see how they look. We want to take them out when they're golden brown and beautiful. Alexa, set a timer for 9 minutes, please.
9 minutes, starting now.
All right, my timer went off. I'm going to go ahead and take my cookies out. Oh, they're beautiful. They're golden brown. They look delicious. I'm going to set them on top of the oven here. I'm going to let them cool for about 15 minutes, and then we'll come back and we'll try one and see how they are. All right, now the cookies have been cooling for about 10 to 15 minutes. We're gonna check on them, see how they taste. What? Why are there bites taken out of my cookie? I don't understand. I don't understand who did that? Who did that? Maggie, did you eat my cookies?
Well, howdy doodly do, kids. How you doing? All right, so you see here, we got this problem here. And it's about Nelson. He's got some sort of math game. Okay, so it says Nelson's playing a math game. He needs to match two cards that show equivalent fractions, shaded fractions, that is, shaded fractions, yep. So which of these cards show a fraction that is equivalent to the fraction on Nelson's card? Oh boy, look at this. We got A, B, C, and D. And which one of these is going to be the same as that one? All right, are you ready? Get your brains working. Here we go.
Yeah, I'm gonna take my horse through the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse through the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
I got the horses in the back. Horse stock is attached. Head is matted black. Got the bushes black to match. Riding on a horse. Ha, you can whip your Porsche. I've been in the valley. You ain't been up off that porch. Now, can't nobody tell me nothing. You can't tell me nothing. Can't nobody tell me nothing.
All right, let's see what you got here, kids. Did you choose the answer gonna be a D? That's correct. Good job, kids. Okay, let's go ahead and analyze this question. So you always want to ask yourself, what do I know? Okay, so I just know that Nelson is playing some math game and he needs to match two cards that show equivalent shaded fractions. Okay, so what is Nelson's fraction here? Well, I do know that there are two parts right here that are shaded, okay? And I have a total of 1, 2, 3 parts. So therefore, my fraction is going to be 2/3 or 2 out of 3. That is the part that is shaded. All right. So then you're wondering, well, how do I get an equivalent fraction out of this? Well, here's kind of a little trick, okay? So when you see this, all right, you can also divide. Here's the beauty of math and fractions. You can divide this figure or this picture, okay, into more pieces, but they have to be equal pieces. So if I were to draw a line. Line from here to here, all I'm doing is I'm extending the existing lines, right? So this line extends here, this line extends here, and this line extends here. Now I have a total of 6 pieces, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And of the 6 pieces, I have 1, 2, 3, 4 pieces that are shaded. So therefore, this fraction here is going to be 4 out of 6. Okay, so these fractions look different, but they're actually the value of it. They're equal. They're the same. All right. So it's kind of like, you know, remember, if you come home and it's hot outside, and so you take your jacket off, are you the same person? Yes, you are. You just took your jacket off. That's it. Okay. All right. So therefore, I know that 2/3 is equal to 4 out of 6. All right. So now I know that the equivalent fraction is 4 out of 6. Which one of these is going to be 4 out of 6? Well, let's look at A. A is 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 total parts. 2 of them are shaded. Therefore, this fraction is 2 out of 4. This can't be the answer. So look at this fraction. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pieces total. However, I have 2 parts that are shaded. Therefore, this fraction is correct, 2 out of 6. But 2 out of 6 is not the same as 4 out of 6, right? No. This fraction, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This has 8 pieces, but and it has 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 pieces are shaded. This fraction here is 4 out of 8, but 4 out of 8 is not the same as 4 out of 6, okay? So therefore, I'm left with this. This is the answer. Now, if you look, here's also another trick. If you look and you just focus on this piece right here, pretend this line is not here, this piece, this shaded piece looks like that shaded piece. You see? So it's kind of a way to see it, but the best way to do these questions is you want to extend, you want to make more pieces, more equal pieces. And by doing that, you can extend the lines, the existing lines.
Hello, kids. How are you doing today? Mr. T is not here because after going to the Old Town Road, he probably went to the dark side. Ha 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 ha. I am now your new math teacher. My name is Vader. Math Vader. So let's go ahead and attempt this problem. It says that point P on the number line represents two equivalent fractions. Which two equivalent fractions can point P represent? Is it going to be A, B, C, or D? Good luck to you kids, and yes, you may use the dark force to help you. Okay, I hope you chose the right answer. Did you guys choose C? Alright, good job. And may the force be with you.
It's a celebration.
Okay, let's go ahead and try to understand why C is the answer, okay? So on a number line, each part of the number line can represent a fraction, all right? So point P is going to be, there's actually infinite number of fractions, but right now we're only going to focus on two equivalent fractions, all right? So how do we get P to become a fraction? Well, let's first try to get the denominator, the total parts that you see between 0 and 1, okay? And in order to do that, you want to count the number, you want to count these spaces between, okay, these partitions. So this is the first space right here. I consider them space for the first part, second part, third part, and fourth part. So there's four parts, okay? Four parts between 0 and 1, so therefore a total of 4, and that is going to be my denominator, the bottom number. All right, so we have a total of 1 part, 2, 3, 4. Now, in order to get the numerator, the numerator, the top numbers, you want to count out where these parts are, right? So this spot right here is going to be 0 out of 4, right? Okay, so this is 0 out of 4, nothing. The value of this part right here is going to be the first part, or I consider it as 1/4, 1 out of 4. This part right here, right, is the next part, which is the second part, the first part, the second part, or 2 out of 4. Well, we know that 2 out of 4 is the same thing as 1/2, right? So if P was moved right here, it's 1/2 between 0 and 1, 2 out of 4. This is the third part, or 3 out of 4. And this is the fourth part, or 1/2, which is 4 out of 4. So I know now P is 1/4 between 0 and 1, right? The distance of P is 1/4 between 0 and 1. So therefore, it cannot be B, right? So P cannot be 1/3 or 2/6 from 1. It's actually 1/4, okay? And if it's 1/4, it cannot be 3 out of 4. It can't be here and here, right? So therefore, it cannot be D. Okay, so it's either going to be A or it's going to be C. Okay? Okay, let's try to figure out which one is it going to be. Is it going to be A or is it going to be C? Well, I do know the first fraction is 1/4, right? So then now you're like, Mr. T, how do I get the second fraction? I don't get it. Well, the beauty of math here is this. Remember how I said that P, there's infinite number of parts or infinite number of fractions where P is? If and only if you divide every single one of these equally into equal parts. So what do I mean by that? Well, here, I can actually divide between here and here, divide it by half, right? And from here to here, divide it again from here to here, divide it in half from here to here, divide it in half. Now I have a total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 total parts. Okay? And with 8 total parts, I'm going to count the positions or the part where P is now. So this right here is 0 out of 8. This right here is 1 out of 8, 1/8, right? It's the distance between 0 and 1. This is 1/8. And this is going to be 2/8, 3/8, 4/8, or 1/2, 5/8, 6/8, 7/8, and 1/8/8. So the equivalent fraction is not going to be 1/8, but rather 2 out of 8. Right here, 2 out of 8 is equal to 1/4. Okay, I can also say that 4 out of 8 is equal to 2 fourths, and 6 out of 8 is equal to 3 fourths. Okay?
All right, let's go ahead and compare some fractions. Which one of these fractions is going to be the greatest? Is it going to be 3 fifths, 2 fifths, 4 fifths, or 1 fifth? Okay, and the answer is 4 fifths. That is correct. 4 fifths is greater than 3 fifths, 2 fifths, and 1 fifth. And if you look at the picture, you can see that there are more pieces that are shaded. Okay, so 4 fifths is the greatest. Okay, let's go ahead and try this one. So, you're going to put these fractions in order from the least to the greatest. Good luck! Okay, and here is the answer. The least is going to be 1/10, then 1/7, 1/6, 1/4, and the greatest is 1/2. Good job, kids!
Alright, let's go ahead and try to figure out why this is the order going from 1/10 being the least to 1/2 being the greatest. Because you might be wondering, well, 10 is greater than 2, Mr. T. How is that possible? Yes, 10 is greater than 2 in terms of whole numbers, but we're talking about fractions here, okay? So let's look at what does 1/10 look like. This is what 1/10 looks like. Here's 1/7, 1/6, 1/4, and 1/2. And so I always want to ask myself, pretend these are all
a whole entire thing of pizza, okay? So a whole pizza here. And so if you had a whole pizza, would you want to share it with 10 people or share it with just you and a friend? Right? Well, obviously, you would just want to share with you and a friend, right? Because that means you get to have half this slice of, half of this, half of a whole of a pizza. Whereas if you shared it with 10 people, you only get this itty-bitty little slice right here. Same as if you shared it with 4 people, you get this slice, but it's less than this. However, it's more than this. So, in terms of ordering from fractions, comparing fractions, you always want to see if the numerator is the same. Okay, you can have different denominators. You know, would you rather share it with less people or with more people? If you share with more people, you're going to get a smaller slice or smaller piece. All right?
Okay, thanks for listening. Hope you guys have a great week.
That's all, folks.